Okay, welcome to Respiratory Pharmacology. We're going to start by looking at the two topics. So the first one includes antihistamines and decongestants, nasal steroids, then antitussives and expectorants. The second section we'll talk about is asthma and anaphylaxis. So let's start with antihistamines and decongestants. So first about histamine, we want to make sure we understand the tale of two receptors. When does the body release histamine? Well, when allergens attach to mast cells and basophils. Histamine activates histamine 1 receptors, which have to do with vasodilation, vascular permeability, and bronchoconstriction. Those are the things you think about when you think about an allergic reaction. On the other side, we have histamine 2 receptors, which have to do with gastric acid secretion, which we talked about in the GI section. So let's first clarify which drugs belong to which camp. So on the H1 receptor antagonists, we have first generation versus second generation. The first generation diphenhydramine or Benadryl, this is something that would make someone sleepy. And the improvement from first to second generation was going to cetirizine or loratadine, which are Zyrtec and Claritin. And these don't cause the same kind of sedation that a first generation antihistamine does. On the other side, we have the H2 receptor antagonists, famotidine, brand Pepcid, and ranitidine, brand Zantac. And notice that the endings or stems are a bit different. So you have loratadine, which is A-T-A-D-I-N-E, and then T-I-D-I-N-E, which is an H2 receptor. So they sound very, very similar when you're talking about sounding it out or making a verbal order. So we need to be very careful that we're not giving someone who's got nasal allergies something for their stomach and something for their, or the reverse, which is somebody who has stomach acid, not giving them something that's going to help them with their nasal allergies. So a first generation antihistamine, and we call it antihistamine, although it's an H1 blocker, because it was the first one and they didn't know an H2 was coming down the line. So generally, when we say antihistamine, we mean the allergy kind. Diphenhydramine or Benadryl crosses the blood-brain barrier easily. It has a high H1 receptor affinity in the CNS, and that causes that drowsiness. Indications? Well, mild allergy symptoms, that runny nose or sneezing, watery eyes, itching. Also, insomnia. Short-term, if somebody has trouble sleeping, this can help, though there is that morning hangover that they just maybe don't feel well rested, although they maybe have slept longer than they would have without the drug. Adverse effects, so drowsiness, reduced reaction time if they're driving, dry mouth, urinary retention. These are what are called anticholinergic effects or antimuscarinic effects. And first generation antihistamines are notorious for them, and they make it very uncomfortable to take them. So when the second generation came around, they were a welcome relief. Cetirizine, brand Zyrtec, and loratadine, brand Claritin, they don't cross the blood-brain barrier easily, and that reduces those CNS side effects or that drowsiness. They also have longer half-lives than the first generation, so just once daily dosing usually does it. What kind of indications do we have? Well, same thing, mild allergy symptoms, runny nose, sneezing, watery eyes, and itching. Obviously, no insomnia indication because they don't really make someone drowsy. But we did put on the right-hand side, sometimes you will get some drowsiness with this, but certainly not to the extent that you would with diphenhydramine. Something that gets confused with allergies is sinus congestion. And this is inflamed sinus blood vessels. They take up excess fluid, and they don't always cause a runny nose. The treatment is to reduce the sinus inflammation by locally forcing the fluid out of the vessels through localized vasoconstriction. Vaso meaning vessel, constriction meaning tightening, so a tightening of the vessels. Sudafedrine, or brand Sudafed, is the most famous of them. It's a sympathomimetic action, and sympathetic is the sympathetic fight or flight system. And a mime is someone that copies you. So a sympathomimetic is something that copies the sympathetic nervous system. It activates those alpha-1 adrenergic receptors. So it's indicated for allergic rhinitis and nasal and sinus congestion. Adverse drug reactions? Well, CNS excitement, restlessness, insomnia, maybe some anxiety. cardiovascular hypertension, tachycardia. So those are maybe a concern, especially if someone has a cardiovascular disease. While we're not saying that someone who has controlled high blood pressure should never use something that's a decongestant, we're saying that certainly a prescriber will want to look at the case and make sure that it's safe. Now, pseudoephedrine is a drug of abuse. It can, you can manufacture methamphetamine with it. And because of the Combat Methamphetamine Act of 2005, it's only available behind the counter, so you can't just get it off the shelf. Pharmacists hand it to you. You don't need a prescription, but you may need to scan your driver's license or something to be put into a database to make sure that you're not going over the maximum of 9 grams per month and 3.6 grams on any one day of medication to any one person. On the other side, some states like Iowa has decided to have a stronger law, and it's 7.5 grams instead of the 9 grams. So manufacturers formulated products with phenylephrine, another decongestant that doesn't have any restrictions on purchasing. Okay, so it has, it has the same actions as the pseudoephedrine and all the same things, but it doesn't work very well because it has an extensive liver metabolism. And so when you see, okay, well, I'll just get the PE version over the counter, it's not quite as good. Oxymetazoline, brand Afrin. This is a topical decongestant. We give it by nasal spray. Minimal side effects. It works within a couple minutes, but we can't use it for more than 3 days because of rebound congestion. That's when you use the medicine, but it actually comes back worse than it was before. So just a few days is what we're okay using oxymetazoline for. It makes sense that with allergy symptoms, one might combine an antihistamine and decongestant. So loratadine, brand Claritin, plus D for decongestant is one combination. So second generation antihistamine that doesn't make you drowsy with a decongestant or pseudoephedrine. So it treats allergic rhinitis with congestion by reducing that sneezing, runny nose, itchiness, and that inflammation and congestion. When someone has seasonal allergies annually, it's really a lot better to use a nasal steroid. And then we'll also talk about cough, which is the antitussives and expectorants. Triamcinolone or Nasacort 24-hour, and it sounds just like it is, nasal corticosteroid. It's dosed once daily, take it up to 2 to 3 weeks to be fully effective. So it's not for PRN use, and that really puts off a lot of people. They are uncomfortable now. They don't want to have to take something every day, but this works a lot better than treating with antihistamines. You've got some mild adverse drug reaction, nose drying of the nose, nosebleeds, burning and itching, sore throat, headache, but it's really the most effective medicine for prevention and treatment of seasonal allergies. So if you take it as you should, 2 or 3 weeks later, it's going to be a completely different story. One antitussive is dextromethorphan, which is the DM in Robitussin DM. It activates opioid receptors in the brain's cough center, and it suppresses that cough reflex. It's derived from codeine, but with minimal side effects at normal doses. Adverse drug reactions, similar to opioids, but certainly not to the same extent. Some dizziness, somnolence, fatigue are possible. Guaifenesin is an expectorant that increases the respiratory mucus volume and decreases the viscosity. It's easier to cough out, and it's often in combination with antitussives. So two combinations that we might see are the over-the-counter guaifenesin with dextromethorphan, or that Robitussin DM, or the prescription-only guaifenesin with codeine, which is Chiritussin AC. So let's talk about asthma a little bit, and we'll first have a graphic that kind of goes over the big picture, and then we'll see how these drugs work in those different pictures. So it all begins with some kind of allergen or some kind of trigger. And then histamine, leukotrienes, these are mediator compounds that get released. And now we have the two big components of asthma. On the left, we have inflammation. On the right, bronchial hypersensitivity, where you have an easily triggered spasm. Maybe some of the triggers are exercise or cold air or smoke. Either way, we get this limited airflow or bronchoconstriction, and then we have bronchospasm. Okay, so to summarize this, the two things we're really worried about are the asthma symptoms that result from one, chronic inflammation, and two, bronchoconstriction. So we're going to treat the symptoms to prevent this bronchospasm by treating those two components. Okay. We'll start with leukotrienes. They're released in the presence of allergens, and they're responsible for smooth muscle constriction, like bronchoconstriction, inflammatory responses, and recruiting further inflammatory mediators. And montelukast, or singulair, it's meant to help, but very rarely it may cause mood changes, but otherwise it's very similar to placebo. But again, we're seeing these mediator compounds released, and we're trying to block that with this leukotriene receptor blocker. A drug that's more for a severe allergy issue would be something like omalizumab, Branzolair. It's a monoclonal antibody, and we see the MAB or MAB at the end of the word, but it complexes with the IgE in the blood. It reduces the amount of available to the receptors and mast cells. So reducing the mediator compound amount release, it only works for the allergy-related asthma, but it's meant to stop the cascade in its track at the mediator step. Indications, moderate to severe asthma, ages 12 and up, and then adverse drug reactions, an injection site reaction or a respiratory infection, maybe anaphylaxis. But again, this is not a first line. This is certainly for someone that's been struggling and has allergy-related condition. Oral glucocorticoids, these are oral steroids that act through anti-inflammatory actions. So for acute asthma exacerbations rather than chronic treatment. So prednisone or methylprednisolone. Prednisone you can give in short bursts in asthma. It's only available as an oral formulation. Whereas methylprednisolone, it's a short burst, but you can get it as an oral tablet or an IV. Note that glucocorticoids can raise glucose levels, and you can see glucose and glucocorticoid have the same beginning. And that's one way to remember the connection. But watch the diabetic patients closely, because if they're on these medications, it's a real concern. There are many different inhaler types, as there are many different levels of people that get asthma, so from children to adults to the elderly. And a lot of times we're choosing it by how easy or hard it is to use. Something like a rescue inhaler, a metered dose inhaler, requires a significant amount of dexterity. So if you have someone that has arthritis or severe arthritis, that's going to be very difficult for them. Where a dry powder might need a little bit less, it can be activated by the breath. Or a Respimat, where you've got this mist created with pressure. So the nebulizer, it's really kind of in its own class, where if you have a patient that's bedridden or something like that, you may have to put it in the nebule. It'll aerosolize it, and they might put a mask on or something like that. So four different inhaler types and ways to get the medicine to the patient. So let's first talk about the inhaled corticosteroids, ICS. They're for long-term use with minimal systemic absorption, which means that basically if you put it directly in the lungs, it's not going to get to the rest of the body. The localized anti-inflammatory action in the lungs makes it much, much safer. So fluticasone or Flovent HFA is one. Budesonide is often combined with other agents. The issue we have is that inhaled corticosteroids can cause oral candidiasis and dysphonia. So oral candidiasis is thrush, or that white tongue, and then dysphonia is being hoarse. So prevent it by rinsing out after using it each time. So on the side of bronchoconstriction, we've got the beta-2 receptor agonists, and they activate these beta-2 receptors in the airways, causing bronchodilation, and they relieve and prevent bronchospasm. Again, beta-1, you have one heart, so that affects the heart generally. Beta-2, you have two lungs, this generally affects the lungs. And we have it as a short and long acting. So if you look at the bottom of the words, short acting beta-2 agonist, that makes SABA. or long-acting beta-2 agonist, that's LABA. We could use a SABA for, it's a rescue inhaler, really, or albuterol. And then the long-actings are preventative. These are things you're supposed to take each day, but never alone, because a trial showed that the outcomes were worse if someone took it alone. They're going to be in combination with some kind of steroid. Anticholinergics, or short or long-acting muscarinic antagonists, SAMA or LAMA, these prevent bronchoconstriction by blocking muscarinic cholinergic receptors in the lungs. And those two words mean the same thing. I just wanted to put them both there so you could see them. Muscarin was a mushroom, and that's how they first discovered it, but then they realized that acetylcholine was the actual neurotransmitter, so then we call it cholinergic now instead of muscarinic. Usually used more in COPD than asthma, so chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. And you have ipratropium, which is Atrovent, and tiotropium, or tiotropium, which is Spiriva. And it's up to you to remember that the ipratropium is short-acting, and most of us remember it because we'll see ipratropium with albuterol, and knowing albuterol is short-acting, ipratropium must be short-acting, and that combination is very familiar. Tiotropium, that's long-acting, 24 hours as well. So the combined agents is when you take two and you're going to attack both the inflammation and the bronchoconstriction. So which again is for the inflammation? That one that has sone in it or something like that. So fluticasone, budesonide. And then the salmeterol is the one that's for that bronchoconstriction that patients have that narrows their airway. On the other side, we could use a SABA and a SAMA, which is a short-acting beta-2 agonist and a short-acting muscarinic antagonist. So albuterol and ipratropium. So albuterol, so on the right-hand side, we have a SABA and a SAMA, so albuterol and ipratropium, both affecting bronchoconstriction. Call it duo-neb because there's two drugs and it goes in nebulized solution. Careful again, using an inhaled corticosteroid, must rinse their mouth after use. Anaphylaxis, so this is when an allergen can cause a very severe allergic reaction. It can happen within minutes, affecting beta receptors, causing vasodilation, bronchoconstriction, bronchospasm. They struggle to breathe. And usually we use an EpiPen or epinephrine, which acts rapidly on those alpha and beta receptors throughout the body. It's given IM or intramuscularly. And we still want to take the patients to the ED after the epinephrine dose to ensure safety, because the body might eliminate the medication before the allergen.